Okay. Hey, good morning. Great to see everybody today. Let's stand together, please.
Almighty, most holy God, faithful through the ages, Almighty, most holy Lord, glorious Almighty God. Almighty, most holy God, faithful through the ages, Almighty, most holy Lord, glorious Almighty God. Almighty, most holy God, faithful through the ages, Almighty, most holy Lord, glorious Almighty God.
I sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. I sing praise to your name, oh Lord, glory to your name, oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I want to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you, O Mighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I want to do. I give you praise. My righteousness. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you.
On a beautiful morning, and lift up the name of the Lord, the Son of the living God, and our Savior. And as we enter into this week, where we focus on you finishing your mission of bringing all the prophecies to close, and how you conquered death and rose again, and because of that we have life. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that we have this time to do this today. To give that focus to you. May we use this time to focus on Jesus Christ, our Savior. We thank you for everybody here, for anybody not here today, may you be with them, Holy Spirit, that all together we can lift up the name of the Lord and worship the name of the Lord together. We thank you for our brother Kenny, who persevered and finished the race. And Lord, he heard those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." We thank you for Christy and Sandy and Ricky and McKenna and everybody part of that family. May you help them, Holy Spirit, as we pick up the pieces and move on. And all together, wherever we are in that race, may we follow that example, Lord, and persevere, knowing that the name of Jesus is our Savior. You are wonderful, Lord. You are magnificent, you are marvelous, and you are the Creator. We give you all the praise and the honor and the glory and worship you. It's in Jesus' name, amen.
I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I want to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you, Almighty. There is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you.
Amen. A wonderful week here in the life of Paoli Christian Church and churches all over the world as we celebrate Jesus bringing us life, and he gave his life. So this is the week of Passover, and on Thursday was the Passover dinner, and then we know what happened on Friday, and then on Saturday, and on Sunday morning, we discovered he is risen. We hope that you'll plan on coming and joining us. We have a service on Friday, for Good Friday, and our Easter sunrise service is at 8 a.m., We have a breakfast and our regular worship that day. Everything's in your bulletin. Please check those out. I will call upon the Lord. Amen. Here we go.
Amen.
Yeah. Crank it up, Cannon.
I will call upon the Lord.
I will call upon the Lord.
Who is worthy to be praised. Shall I be saved from my enemies? I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord.
I will call upon the Lord.
Who is worthy to be praised?
Who is worthy to be praised?
So shall I be saved from my enemies? I will. And let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. And let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted.
exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You were my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all my desire. No one else will do. Nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find the way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're all I want. You're all.
Today is Palm Sunday, the day we Christians celebrate the Sunday before Easter. It celebrates Jesus Christ's humble yet triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He was greeted by ecstatic throngs, shouting, "Hosanna in the highest," and waving palm branches signifying victory. The event surrounding Christ's entry into Jerusalem is recorded in all four Gospels' accounts: Matthew 21, 1 through 11, Mark 11, 1 through 11, Luke 19, 28 through 44, and John 12, 12 through 19. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem was prophesied in the Old Testament by Zechariah, Zechariah 9:9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, even a colt, the foal of a donkey. Before the week was out, these same throngs would be shouting, crucify him! Crucify him! In their defense, I would say they did not yet fully know who Christ was or his promise and covenant given to all who believe. We are fortunate to have the gospel accounts of the Last Supper proclaiming the good news. Jesus promised believers everlasting life and fulfilled his part of the covenant through his death, burial, and resurrection. Our Lord asks us to take the emblems of the bread and the cup as often as we gather together. This morning, as I read Luke's account of the Last Supper, I ask you to take the emblems with me when I read chapter 22, verses 19 and 20. Luke 22, 14 through 18. And when the hour had come, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves, for I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. Luke 22:19. And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body. which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Luke 22:20. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant of my blood. Our Lord and Savior, thank you for granting us salvation through your death, burial, and resurrection. Help us to humbly accept your free gift and help us to be the disciples you have called us to be. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need. Christ in me. my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my home and stay. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Let's stand together, please.
I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. With a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, life. You took my darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Song of praise with an outstretched arm, I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. You, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
Obviously, let's welcome back Chuck. He's going to share the word with us today, and please be seated there. Thank you.
Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this wonderful time to come and worship, to celebrate the day that our King chose as every day, humbleness, Father. Not to be confused with other kings of the past, Father. He showed us the right way to live our life, the right way to serve. Father, I ask you to be with the congregation and myself. I pray, Father, for nothing but your glory and honor. And Father, I want to lift up the good pastor family as their Father, mourning a loss in their lives, and just comfort them. Be with those that are traveling. Bring them back safely. And Father, just thank you again for Jesus. Thank you for this opportunity. In Christ's name, amen. Well, brothers and sisters, I want to share with you this morning a passage that's already been shared for the Lord's Supper. That's the scripture that I'm going to be preaching today out of, actually, Matthew chapter 11. Chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. And I want to start off to tell you how this got started. Preacher came to me about, I guess it was 3 weeks ago after he preached. And he said, as he was leaving, he said, shook my hand and said, "What are you preaching on Sunday?" Well, I was shocked. I mean, I didn't want him to think I wasn't prepared 3 weeks early. Even when I used to preach, I never prepared that early, because the Lord would change my mind at the last minute on something. And I said, "Jesus." I didn't know what to say. And so after I left, I thought, well, that was just such a silly answer, you know. And I told him as we was leaving church, I said, I knew it would be Palm Sunday, of course. And I said, "My sermon title is How to Ride Your Donkey." And he laughed. But I've got to thinking about that donkey and how much it relates to Scripture and God and what He wants for our life, and how the donkey responded when he was called. So the sermon title today, the sermon title for today is, "What Can We Learn from a Donkey?" And I'll be honest with you, brothers and sisters, there's a lot we can learn from a donkey. And our scripture comes from, of course, as I've already shared, and I'm going to read it to you. I wanted to read it. It says in Matthew 21, as they approach Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you'll find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send you right away." And this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. And this comes from Zechariah. "Say to daughter Zion," this is the prophecy, "see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, on the foal of a donkey." And the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others would cut branches from the trees and they would spread them on the road, and the crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed, they shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." And so that's our scripture, and I got to thinking about that donkey. And we can learn a lot from a donkey. A few years ago, the national, some of you that are as old as I am will not ask, back in the late 70s, early 80s, the National Ad Council, I don't know if you can remember it or not, but I do very clearly. They placed an ad, and they were trying to get us to wear our seatbelts. You remember before it was law? And they had these two dummies. And so they would run a commercial, and these dummies would be in an accident. And then they would show these dummies as they were thrown all about, their body parts. And then they would say, "Well, you can learn a lot from a dummy." And that's sort of how all of this came about. You can learn a lot from a donkey. So, like I say, we're changing it a little bit. But I want to share with you this morning that I have learned a lot, and I think you'll learn a lot today on this Palm Sunday. Of course, you know, this is the final week of Jesus's bodily form being on this earth, and he knows that he's going to the cross. He knows he's going to die, and of course he's going to rise again Sunday morning. But at the start here in this story, we've got this little figure, this little donkey that I kept thinking about. You know, he don't get much attention. You know, not like Peter or Paul or, you know, or Adam or Ruth in the Bible. They get, you know, a lot of attention. But he just gets one little verse in the Old Testament. And, of course, as you has already been shared, he gets Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But that's it, that about 11 verses. That's it. That's all it's ever said. You know, over the past few weeks, Pastor's been calling us, of course, drawing us to become more like Jesus and everything, you know, that he's been preaching on. He's been sharing about the life of Jesus, and we're studying that, and we see we're called to be holy and to live as Jesus lived. And you know, that intimidates a lot of us. I know it does me. And we're to be good stewards of the life that he gave us, as Jesus was a good steward. He was a excellent steward of his life. He was an excellent steward of holiness. And he leads us into this. He wants to lead us into this attitude of holiness in our life. And he wants us to lead into good stewardships of our lives. You know, everything we have, we only have for a little while. It's like borrowed. It's just borrowed for a time. And if it has of any value, someone else will have it. So everything we've got in this life is just a matter of time. While we may enjoy it, it will be gone. It will be gone for, as far as we're concerned, forever. But we are called to be different, and we're called to be good stewards in our lives. And I think that we can learn a lot from a donkey this morning about that, to continue in that thought. And as we, you know, look at Jesus and the whole purpose of his life. He knew he was going to come and he was going to die. And this was the plan. And his whole life came together this week that we're celebrating. The very breath that he breathed was for this week. Everything that he said was for this week. Every insignificant little thing that's happening is for us to learn and what it means to be a good steward and to live a holy life. And I know that that word holy is intimidating, but you know, holy is not really that intimidating when you think. It just simply means to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. We are to be different. To be holy is to be called out. To be holy is just to be separate from the world. I think that's possible when I look at it in that light. I think, and I know, of course, because it is because of what Jesus has already accomplished on my behalf. And so, the ultimate expression of holiness is Jesus Christ. You know, Him going to the cross. He was so in love with God that He knew there was no other way. I mean, even if there was, He wasn't willing to change anything. He wanted to be completely obedient to the Father. And so, He was so in love with His neighbor that there was no other way. And His life was given for our freedom in Him. Jesus is a great example of a perfect steward of His life. And we're called to be like Christ. We're called to be good stewards. And this morning, from a simple donkey, I'm hoping that I will be able to challenge you. Maybe challenge your thoughts this morning. Maybe help you remember some things. Because you can surely learn a lot from the donkey. First of all, the first thing I want you to learn from the donkey is the donkey was available. That's very important. The donkey was available. You know, as we read through this, we see that the donkey wasn't preoccupied. He didn't have something else going on. He was available immediately for God's use. And I'd like to read a passage of someone available. And from the Old Testament. It comes from 1 Samuel 3:1-14. It should be on the screen. Is that correct? Okay. 1 Samuel 3:1-14. Was Samuel, and let me tell you someone else that was available that's always amazed me, David, the way God would talk to David. You know, one time David, he was talking to God, and I love the way David talked to God. He said, should I go against the Amalekites? And I love the way God talked to David. Well, David, this is scripture. I mean, with the southern version. David, yeah, I want you to attack the Amalekites, but don't go directly against them. I want you to go around back, come around from the rear. Now, this is, and stay there in the poplar trees, and don't move. Now, David, when you hear the sound of an army marching in the top of the poplar trees, then go. And that's what David did. And he said, God said, and when you start to go, David, my army will already be there, and we're going to defeat them. So all you have to do is just lap up the gravy. That's the way I read that verse. But I love that. I wish God talked to me like that. So this morning I want to share with you also a story from Samuel. And 1 Samuel. And Samuel was always available. And so Samuel was asleep one night. Let me pull this up on my phone. He was asleep one night, And God said, Samuel, well, he was sound asleep. And he thought Eli was talking to him. And he said, yes, my Lord, Eli. And Eli said, I didn't, you know, say anything to you. You go on back and lay down. This happened again. And Samuel went in there and said, yes, Eli. No, this must be the Lord calling you. And said, Eli told him. Said, next time he said, your servant is listening, Lord. And so Samuel did exactly what Eli said. He said, your servant is listening, Lord. Just having a conversation. And what amazes to me is just how clear and simple God talks. It says here, Samuel answered, here I am. He said to Eli, my son Eli, he said, do not call, go back, lie down. And then when God calls, talk to him. Of course, the third time. It's always things happen in three. And the Lord came and stood there. Said, Samuel, had to call him twice that time. Samuel said, speak, your servant is listening. The Lord said to Samuel, see, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hear about it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family from beginning to an end. For I told him that I'd judge his family forever because the sin he knew about his sons blaspheming God. And therefore, I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by sacrifice or offering. And then, of course, the wonderful thing about that, or not good for Eli, but the wonderful thing about that is Eli said, Samuel, what did the Lord say? You know, I know you talked to the Lord. What did the Lord say? And he simply told him what the Lord said, and he accepted it. He was available. He was available. You know, I want to be available. I think we should all desire to be available. He wasn't too busy. I shared this with our Thursday night group. Being busy is being under Satan's yoke. And I've always remembered that, and I always try never to say when it comes to the Lord, I'm too busy. Samuel wasn't too busy. David wasn't too busy. Samuel was, you know, soft-hearted and ready when God spoke, and he listened. So Samuel and the donkey are available. What about me? What about you today? Are you available? Are you available for God's use? You know, and so that's the question, and that's the thing we can learn from the donkey here, is if God calls you to surrender your life to Him, are you available? You know, if God calls you, men, to raise your family in the way of the Lord, are you available? Or are you too busy to take that time? Women, if God calls you to train up your children, are you too busy? Are you too busy? The donkey wasn't. He was ready. And so we can learn a lot from a donkey. He was ready. He was available. This little guy was ready for Jesus' use when Jesus was ready. Number two, the donkey was willing. You know, I might be available, but am I willing? Am I willing? I have to ask myself, you know. I don't claim to know a whole lot about donkeys, you know. I know they do have a strong will, just like me. They do. But if a donkey decides he wants to do something or he don't want to do something, I know for a fact it takes a lot to get that donkey to do that. other thing that you want him to do. My grandfather, he told me a story. He said it was true. I believed him. Anytime he said, you ain't going to believe this, it sounds like a lie, but it's true. He lived it. He told a story about a donkey that he used to use in the woods. They'd pull logs. And they'd use anything and everything they had. They'd had every animal but a tractor. And so they would use, they had a big dog, they'd hook it up to something. But anyway, he said they had a donkey. And he said this was the smartest donkey. But boy, this donkey was stubborn. And he said one day, he said we was logging. We was pulling logs. And he said, and this donkey would work so hard. He said it would amaze you how strong and how hard this little donkey would work. But he said, when that donkey got tired, he'd sit down. He said, you'd have to, this is the way he told it, beat on that donkey and beat on that donkey. And that donkey would just sit there and just take it. He's tired. He said, so one time I come up with a bright idea. He said, you had to outthink the donkey. The donkey was sitting there, wouldn't move for nothing. He said, I got a little bit of kindling. I built a little fire under the donkey. He said, the donkey jumped up and he said, went right back to work, didn't have a bit of problems. He said, sometimes you got to be smarter than the donkey. Well, he said, I was so proud of myself until the donkey pulled that log halfway across the creek. He said, sat down right in the middle of the creek. See, it sounds like a lie, but I know he lived that. So, I mean, I know a few things about donkeys. I do. And there's a lot we can learn from the donkey and from this donkey. You know, this donkey in this story of the triumphal entry, you know, nothing seemed to bother him, you know. You know, nothing, you know, think about this, Dale. There were people all around this donkey. There were people shouting. There were people singing. And there were, you know, shouting, yelling, singing, Hosanna, you know, what we read. And blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And this donkey didn't care about all that commotion. He just stayed focused on what he was to do. You see, he quietly carried his precious cargo. He had a surrendered will. Obedience. How often do we come to God not with a surrendered will? You know, I've learned a lot in the Lord, and it's all because of my not surrendered will. Those are lessons I really remember. I always tell people I've never learned anything on the mountaintop. It's always in the valley. And it's usually because of my not surrendered will. And God leads me despite myself. And so we want to do things our way. You know, we want our rights. We want things done to serve and to satisfy us. And when it comes to, you know, spirituality, yeah, but we want it on our terms, not the Lord's. So we can learn from the donkey a lot in this situation. He had a surrendered will. And he did his job. He was available. And so we need to, when we come to the Lord, we have to surrender our will, don't we? And that's hard for some of us. That's hard. You know. But in order for us to come to him, we have to surrender completely. If we're going to be good stewards, we have to surrender. If we're going to have good lives for the Lord, we have to surrender and let him lead. Let him direct. He is our master. We are the servant. And it's interesting, you know, of the gospel accounts in this story, that the colt, did you notice, had never been ridden? It had never been ridden. And Jesus was his very first passenger. It was, the donkey was preserved for Jesus' use. Man, can you imagine the stories this donkey could tell? My very first rider. They was going before me. They was laying out palm branches. They were taking their coats off. My feet didn't even get dirty. Boy, you talking about bragging rights to all the other donkeys. I mean, he had a story to tell because he was obedient. You know, I can't imagine the stories that we'll be able to tell one day for the Lord because of our obedience, us surrendering our will. The donkey was preserved for Jesus. And so as we look at this stewardship of preserving ourselves for Jesus, Galatians 5:13 says, "You, my brothers, were called to be free. But don't use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love." You know, there's a lot of people out here today that are slaves to their sin. And we were called to be free. Jesus came to be free. I've had my experience because of my accident of prescription medication. And I can tell you, it is a sorry slave master. A very sorry slave master. And I'm amazed, and even in my own life, and as I look at others, I see people, how they are enslaved again. You see, Satan, he wants to enslave us. He wants to put a burden on us that we can't hold up under. But Jesus came for the purpose of setting us free. You know, I'm living my very best, I think, for God today. But I know without a doubt that sin is right there, waiting, seeking, just like Satan wanting to devour me. We no longer have to be enslaved by sin. You see, we must be free. We must be preserved for Jesus. And we must preserve ourselves for God's use. If we're going to be good stewards of our lives, and if we are preparing ourselves for God's use, are we staying away from things that will enslave us? Are we being careful about our actions, our speech, our motives, our attitudes? Jesus states this fact that blessing and cursing cannot come from the same mouth. Can fresh water and salt water come from the same spring? Boy, we sure try to, don't we? We try to make that happen, don't we? I know I have. Brothers and sisters, if we tear down people to their face or behind their back, they will never listen to us talk to them about Jesus Christ. Never. We've lost that opportunity. Number three, the donkey was ready for the task at hand. This donkey, you know, it didn't take a whole lot for the disciples to get the donkey and come back. He was ready. The donkey was willing, ready, waiting to be used for the Lord's purpose. I want to be just like that donkey. You know, I like the imagery, you know, that this brings up in my mind. You know, I think about when I was a child, and when there was something I wanted to do, how I was so ready, willing to do it. And when I didn't want to do something, let's say go to the doctor, you know, when I went to the doctor as a child, it would conjure up images of him doing something that I didn't like, and then he'd send that menial nurse in that would jab a needle in my arm the size of the Eiffel Tower. And so, if I didn't want to do it, you had to about beat me just like my grandpa beat that donkey just to get me to go. But if I wanted to do something, oh, I was ready. I was willing. It reminds when I was a kid going to the county fair. I would save my money for weeks working in the hottest part of the summer, the last 3 weeks of our vacation, because I knew the week that school started was our county fair. And we would save our monies just to go to that county fair. And how it was so easy to get me to go to the county fair. It was not hard at all. That needs to be our attitude in living for the Lord and serving the Lord and being willing to live for Him. That should be our attitude. The donkey had an attitude of service-mindedness, as being ready, willing, and not putting up any fight at all. You know, we've all experienced these two sides of our own behavior. Willing, being unprepared, and being prepared. Are we prepared for the task that God has called us? Because brothers and sisters, we all have a task. We all, every one of us here, have ministry. And God, in your mother's womb, prepared you to accomplish this task. You have that ability. He gave it to you. So are we ready? Are we chomping at the bits? Ready to take Jesus on His journey? Because we're all taking Him on a journey. We have a lot to learn from that donkey. We can learn a lot from that donkey. What about, are you ready for where Jesus is taking you? Are you taking Jesus where He wants you to take Him? Are you ready for that task? Am I ready for that task? Are you ready for God's will in your life? You know, I want to say in a little bit lengthy closing, what in the world does all of this have to do? You know, you think about the donkey. Well, that's a silly subject. No, it ain't. Not in how he behaved and how he acted. You know, why did this event even take place? Why did God use this donkey? And He did use that donkey. He used it to teach us. You know, most times, whenever a king comes into an area, back in these days, they didn't come riding on a donkey. Why, they would come in on a big white stallion, you know, trained for war, muscles ripped, looked like Arnold Schwarzenegger as a horse. You know, that's what it would be. Or a big, beautiful black one, you know, just muscles ripping. Look like one of them Clydesdales. You know them, the most majestic horse of all. That's what I'd want to come in on. Not Jesus. You know, donkeys are slow, but they're steady. They can be stubborn, just like us. You know, they're short. Kings don't ride donkeys. Well, most kings don't. There is some very real significance, brothers and sisters, to all of this imagery that we're looking at today. You know, this took place over 2,000 years ago. I mean, think about this. You got to remember, Jesus, He just raised Lazarus from the dead, you know, in the adjacent city, there at Bethany. And some huge miracles had been happening, and the people were now declaring their allegiance to a new king. They're not meant to be subject to any other power. They were eagerly looking for a new king who would come and set them free from their captors. A king that would put those Romans in their place. We all know they were going to hell, right? Because they were against us. God's chosen. See, that's how they thought, a lot like we think today, don't we? We think like that also. And so here comes Jesus, a possible king, but He's not riding a stallion. He's not riding a Clydesdale. He's on a little old donkey. And He's coming, humbling, slowly, humbly into the capital city. Not to wage a physical war against kings or against armies, but to wage a spiritual war that was decisively, by the way, won as He hung on the cross and then rose from the grave. But a war that is still raging to this day in little skirmishes and battles in our own life. And it will continue to go on until the end of time. This battle of good and evil is still being fought. It's being fought in our hearts. The casualties, brothers and sisters, are high. The costs are almost unbearable. But through the smoke of this battle comes a king that is gentle, a king that is loving. He comes to our hearts, and he comes and he offers us freedom from our enemy. He offers us peace in our war. And so, brothers and sisters, in closing, I want to say that this time that the Lord's given us, there's some more imagery I want to share with you. Jesus said, "Are you troubled and heavy laden? Are you carrying a load that you can't bear? Put your yoke upon me. I'll give you rest." You know, a lot of people, let me say this. I know you because you're just like me. Everybody's carrying a burden. Everybody. When you see somebody out there, especially, I understand, first of all, they're hurting. Are they being mean to you? It's because they're hurting. Are they being nice to you? It's because they're trying to hide the fact that they're hurting. Everybody's hurting. Everybody's fighting this war. And the only way, brothers and sisters, that we can ever win is by allowing our yoke to be united with Jesus Christ. You see, when he went to that cross, as he shed his blood, all of our burdens, all of our troubles, all of our hurts, all of the sin was laid there in a package at the foot of the cross, and the blood of Jesus came down and covered it completely. You know, I tell people, when I get to heaven, I'm just so excited to see God, and I know that when I stand there, he's not going to see Chuck, the sinner. He's going to see Jesus Christ. And he's going to see the blood of Christ that covers my sin. And so he's going to see me, and this blows my mind. I'm perfect in his eyes because of the blood of Jesus. I'm perfect. Despite my failures, my shortcomings, and my struggles, I'm perfect because of what Jesus did on the cross. So brothers and sisters and friends, and if there's anybody here never given your life to Jesus Christ, today's a good day. Today is the day of salvation for you. And you can be perfect, just like those of us that have. I hope you make the right choice today. Take that burden and put it on Jesus. And let him carry it. He's more willing and able to accomplish that task.
Stand together, please.
Hi, I'm Gary Swick, and I'd like to thank you for listening to the message this morning at Paoli Christian Church. We hope that what you've heard has touched your heart and encouraged you in your walk with God. We would really like to hear from you if you have any spiritual needs that we might help you with. You can contact us by looking for us online at paolichristianchurch.org or by phone at 812-723-2664. Paoli Christian Church is located at 1700 West Hospital Road in Paoli, Indiana. Once more, thank you for listening, and I hope that you'll listen again next Sunday as we worship God together at Paoli Christian Church.